Bruner's discovery approach to learning. Content outline, Bruner's learning theory, knowledge acquisition process, then examples of discovery learning and scaffolding. At the end of this session, you will be able to discuss Bruner's discovery approach to learning, identify the knowledge acquisition process, give examples of discovery learning, and explain the need of scaffolding in this kind of learning. Bruner's learning theory. Jerome Bruner, in his discovery approach to learning, prescribes certain tips for the teachers to enable learners to attain concepts. And according to him, a learning theory cannot just explain how learning takes place. It has to be prescriptive. It has to state how a particular matter can be best learned. And it also should give strategies for improving learning. Both Ossebel and Bruner have given prescriptions as to how learning can be made effective, while Ossebel focused on concept formation, Bruner focused on concept attainment. Ossebel focused on teacher's role in learning and Bruner focused on the child's role in attaining certain concepts. And we will know more in detail about the process of learning and also the process of acquisition of the knowledge, which has been analyzed by Bruner beautifully. Bruner focused on the process of knowledge acquisition rather than on the information or the product of that particular knowledge. In the science classes also, sometimes we teachers say, if you mix this with this, this happens. There is no scope for curiosity. There is no excitement. The child gets a bit of information, which in science he has to accept without verification. This, in essence, is a wrong method of teaching a subject like science. Why science? For example, any subject can be taught wherein the child can be hypothesizing and verifying on his or her own. So learners should be acquiring knowledge in the exact process in which it was generated. How does a knowledge generation process work? First, one explores, then hypothesizes, then experiments, verifies, and concludes. So let the children experience the process of generating knowledge rather than merely getting the product. So then they will feel like being in the place of a discoverer. They will feel all the excitement and curiosity of a discoverer. And towards the end, when they discover something and understand and then are able to represent that knowledge, they will have that satisfaction of acquiring some knowledge. Bruner emphasizes the nature of persons as knowers. We as persons, how do we feel when we are to acquire knowledge? Without curiosity, do we make efforts to know about the things? No. First of all, our curiosity should be triggered. When you look at certain things, what is this? How is this? Why does it happen? These are all questions which are asked by children generally. So we also have that inherent curiosity to know about the things around us. So Bruner emphasizes this quality of human beings, the nature of us as knowers. Bruner also has analyzed the structure of knowledge. What knowledge consists of, how it is acquired, and how the knowledge is to be transacted. He focuses on the process of acquiring knowledge. What is the process through which we all go while acquiring the knowledge? In that particular sequence, we all move from concrete to abstract. For example, we all want to know about plants. How do we learn about plants? We pull out a plant from the soil, examine its roots, touch its stem, leaves, and try to know about its texture, then look at a tree, and then again feel, try to pull out, realize that it doesn't come out. So a set of actions help us to understand more about that particular thing about which we want to gain knowledge. After having explored through actions, then we look at the textual matter, which gives us more information about them, the images, the diagrams, and other things which throw more light on our understanding of the plants and trees. And then toward the end, our understanding about the plants and trees, we try to put in the form of words and, if necessary, some symbols. Because words are also a system of symbols, and we can be using some formulae also to represent the knowledge which we have just gained. So the process of acquisition of knowledge involves three phases: inactive, iconic, and symbolic. And each stage acts as a scaffolding for the next stage. Each stage is a prerequisite for the next one. Just to imagine that we teachers start with the symbolic stage, ignoring the first two, the inactive and iconic. Is it logical? Let us delve a few moments trying to know more about the process of knowledge acquisition. What happens in the inactive phase? Children learn by manipulating objects, by moving things, by keeping things one on the other, and just observing which kind of surface helps objects to stand and which one make them topple and all such things. So in short, in order to know about things, we manipulate on the environment. We act upon the environment. In other words, knowledge acquisition process in the beginning is inactive, which involves a set of actions on the object about which we want to know. While the first step in the knowledge acquisition is inactive, the child explores a particular situation, manipulates, tries to understand. I gave the example of the plant. The child pulls out the plants, various kinds of plants, goes near the tree, realizes it cannot be pulled out, finds that the stem of the plants is very soft, whereas that of the trees is hard. In this way, the child acquires a lot of knowledge by acting upon the situation about which he or she wants to know. And then the next step is that of getting more information about that particular situation by observing movies, videos, pictures of that particular phenomena or the object. And this step is called the iconic. That's why even in the classes, the teachers will have to show the children a lot of movies, videos, visuals about something which they have to study. But then that should come only after the children interact with the situation and then understand it to some extent. For example, if the children are being taught the latitude and longitude of different places, instead of the teacher just showing on a map, the children can be making use of the atlas, and the teacher can be just asking them to find out the latitude and longitude of, let us say, Delhi or that of Africa or that of Australia, so that they do it on their own and then they realize. And after that, they can be getting many pictures which will explain the latitude and longitude of particular countries. And then towards the end, they can be shown a table which consists of the latitudes and longitudes of different places. So in this way, a knowledge acquisition process has to move from inactive to iconic and then to symbolic. The third phase is symbolic. After having explored on our own through manipulation, then we get more information through diagrams, movies, charts, and such pictures, and then whatever knowledge we have acquired through our actions and through our observation of these pictures and others, we try to come out with some definition in using words or using some formulae. So the third stage is the symbolic stage of process of knowledge acquisition, and it is the final stage in which we represent our thoughts in the form of symbols. Bruner emphasizes the nature of knowledge acquisition process. He says that we have to put children through the same process through which the knowledge is acquired by children. Otherwise, we are curbing their curiosity and making the whole process just an ordeal. What is this nature of knowledge acquisition process? It has to move from inactive to iconic, iconic to symbolic. That is, exploring the environment, then hypothesizing as to its possibilities, as to why it is like that, and then experimenting upon the situation to find out whether our hypothesis is true or not, and then verifying the hypothesis to come to a conclusion and representing our conclusion using symbols. The examples of discovery learning are, examples of discovery learning are many. Let us begin with incidental learning. Through TV, through our peer group, and even while exploring whatever environment around us, at home, in the school, while going to the picnic or on the spot, incidentally we come across many things which are new, and we try to see what they are and why they are there and what happens if we manipulate on that and all. So this kind of learning through which we come across incidentally is called incidental learning. Next is site-based learning. Nowadays, children are taken to different sites wherein they will not be compartmentalizing their knowledge as history, geography, or science or whatever. They try to explore the site as a whole situation. We call this as holistic learning. For example, let us take our children to a place of historical interest. Let us say Qutub Minar. Then what the children will get to learn? They will use language to know more about the history of that place, the architectural uniqueness of that particular thing, and also the surroundings, the flora and the fauna there and all that. So this kind of learning also inherently involves students inquiring into that particular site to find out what it has got to offer in the form of knowledge. Next method which is useful for discovery learning is guided discovery. It is not possible for us to teach so many things within such a short time of schooling. So in order to hasten the process of discovery, what we can do is plan for activities which may lead to some discoveries, manipulations, which can be guided by the teacher, so that the process of knowledge acquisition from inactive to iconic and iconic to symbolic takes place faster than it would actually happen in a natural situation. Problem-based learning is another way of teaching to enable students to discover on their own. Some problems can be posed for which the students will have to find answers. For example, we have certain cities which have developed haphazardly, and there are some cities which are emerging in a planned manner, and students may be posed with a problem of changing the city planning of a particular place where they are living from the haphazard one to a systematic one, and this can be designed by the students, and this can be a problem based learning. Similarly, several problems can be identified by the teacher depending upon the situation and depending upon the age level, interest level and all that, and those problems can be solved by the students as a team with a little guidance by the teacher. In some situations which may be a little dangerous, for example, we cannot make children interact with an environment where there may be earthquakes or volcanoes or where there may be some natural disaster. In such situations, we can be making use of simulations and then make students interact with that particular medium to understand the cause and effect relationship of that particular concept, and then take them further through the inquiry process and also through hypothesizing. Case-based learning is also another discovery learning approach in which we give a particular situation and a problem can be identified based on that case, and the students will be asked to solve that problem. For example, if there are mangroves which are growing in a particular area, how to protect those mangroves, how to prevent people from trespassing that environment, what design has to be made for traffic, what precautions are to be taken, what posters will have to be put, and all that can be one kind of case-based learning. Why scaffolding? Let us, with an example, understand how scaffolding can be done by a teacher in order to make children understand a particular concept. Let us see about friction. What is friction? Instead of teacher defining friction and giving several examples, What the teacher can do is create certain situations in the classroom wherein there are different objects, balls and small toy cars and others which are available, and different kinds of surfaces, smooth, rough, and similarly the chalkboard where a part of it is oiled, floor, a part of it is powdered, and the children are asked to move the vehicles on these, and even they can be actually moving themselves on the powdered part of the floor and also on the rough part of the road. The children can be asked to write on the oiled part of the board and also on the rough part of the board, and children will have to realize on their own what facilitates movement, what stops movement, where the objects move faster, where they move slower. And then the teacher can be asking questions as to why friction happens. What is friction in the first place? It is resistance to motion. And where does it happen more, where it happens less? And then the question can be whether friction is good for us or bad for us. In some situations, yes, in some situations, no. But then all these are not to be explained by the teacher. She has to elicit from the students by their actual experimentation with the situation which she has provided. And towards the end, the teacher will have to supplement saying that, giving the definition of friction and then saying friction sometimes is useful and sometimes harmful. When we walk, we need friction. When we write, we need friction. But at the same time, when machines are to be used and when the parts have friction, then wear and tear happens. And we need friction to apply brakes to the vehicles and all such things. So in this process which has been exemplified, the teacher is always there by the side of children, but the children are there to actually explore, operate upon the environment and learn on their own, and they can always be inquiring into that particular phenomenon to find out on their own what is friction, what causes friction, which surfaces cause more friction, and whether it is useful to us or not. Why we need scaffolding? First, let us understand what is scaffolding. It is the process in which a mentor gives maximum support in the beginning when the child is not able to go through this knowledge acquisition process on his or her own. And then as and when the child becomes capable of acquiring that knowledge, the support is weaned away. And how can we give this support in the beginning to enable children to learn on their own? By giving analogies that can facilitate imagination or abstraction. For example, a child may not be knowing the difference between a cube and a cuboid, what is a square and a rectangle. So in such cases, the use of manipulatives in the teaching of math will try to make abstract concepts concrete. If you understand Pythagoras' theorem, a model can be made in which we can be representing the squares on the two sides of the right angle and then bring all those and put above this square which is made in the hypotenuse, we will be able to illustrate how the sum of the squares on the hypotenuse is equal to the sum of the squares on the other two sides. So giving some examples to understand the atomic structure, can that be the structure of the solar system? So in this way, through analogies, we can take children to higher order thinking at a faster pace. How can we facilitate children's inquiry and make them discover on their own? One is inquiry-based approach. We have even an inquiry-based training model, inquiry training model it is called, in which the children will have to ask questions, inquiring into a particular situation or a phenomenon, and the teacher will be answering only by yes or no, and through that she will guide their thinking, and then this process of hypothesizing will be toward the end leading to a particular conclusion. For those people who are more interested in this inquiry training model, they can refer to the Models of Teaching book by Bruce Joyce and Marsha Wheel. And there is that inductive reasoning. As we all know, thinking about particular and then coming towards general is inductive reasoning. Many examples are to be given to the children, after analyzing which the children will come towards a conclusion and a generalization. Bruner has come out with a concept attainment model which illustrates this inductive reasoning process, in which The teacher only facilitates by giving positive exemplars and negative exemplars, and the children will have to look into the positive and negative and come out with the essential common attributes of a concept, and then they are supposed to define that concept by generalizing. So, in order to teach a concept, unlike Ossebel, who focused on the teacher's role in concept formation, Bruner emphasizes the role of child in attaining a particular concept. So, we call this as concept attainment, and inductive reasoning is the essence of concept attainment, in which the child will be throughout the process active, analyzing, comparing, classifying, and then generalizing. And the spiral construction of curriculum is another essential thing which is necessary for concept formation and concept attainment. What do we mean by spiral construction of curriculum? In lower classes, you introduce certain concepts and build on those concepts in more specificity and more detail as they come to the higher classes. For example, in lower classes, we talk about respiration as breathing and photosynthesis as preparation of food by the plants. And as the children go to higher classes, the chemical reactions that are involved and the details of the processes which are involved are all discussed about the same topics in more detail. So such spiral construction of curriculum also enables to scaffold children's thinking from easy to difficult, simple to complex, and concrete to abstract. So students, we have learnt about Bruner's discovery approach to learning. It is a cognitive theory. It is also a constructivist theory, because Bruner emphasizes the role of students in learning on their own, in constructing knowledge on their own. In order to arrive at the theory, Bruner analyzed the process of acquisition of knowledge, which consists of three phases: inactive, iconic, and symbolic. And he also talks about putting the children through the same processes in order to arrive at concept attainment, that is, first allowing students to manipulate over the situation, that is exploration, then hypothesizing, then inquiring, and then generalizing, and then representing the knowledge in a symbolic form, in the form of definition or formulae. And what is the role of the teacher? The teacher is a facilitator who can be, towards the end, supplementing. The tips for the teacher is to keep the language simple, to explain with minimum words, and to follow a logical sequence. And the steps which are involved in discovery approach to learning are activation, that is arousing curiosity, maintenance, sustaining the curiosity by allowing students to inquire into that phenomena, and then giving direction to their thinking so as to keep their thinking in the right track, which can lead to generalization and definition of that particular concept. Thank you.